Once there was a preacher by the name of Ted Haggard, who stumbled from the path, or you might even say staggered. He was one in a million, or more aptly, one in ten. Some folks say he put the men in amen. He preached the gospel message of intolerance and self-loathing, and traveled on his wayward way betraying his betrothing. He was the soul of piety and no one doubted him, until he hired a gigolo and used a pseudonym. So he humbly went to counseling, and then 3 weeks later he's born again, again. Because Ted Haggard is completely heterosexual. Ted Haggard is completely heterosexual.
Hello everybody, welcome to the Atheist Experience. We are live at a Sunday, June 1st, 2008. That was Ted Haggard is completely heterosexual.
Hi, thanks for waiting.
I'd like to know if at some point you guys were Christians and then made a choice not to believe in that, or what's the deal?
Okay, thanks. We can do.
Sure.
Yeah.
I was.
Paper, scissors, who starts?
I don't think it's a choice. Mm-hmm. I didn't make a choice. I don't think you choose what your beliefs are. I think your beliefs are the result of being convinced of the truth of something. I was raised primarily Southern Baptist, went to a bunch of different churches, it's usually Baptist. I was a Christian to varying degrees at different times in my life, from the age of 5 to, and I was more active as a teenager, both with church stuff and, with mission opportunities. I went in the Navy for about 8 years after I got out of the Navy. I still believed, but I didn't go to church. I wasn't practicing, didn't have these beliefs. And then around 2000-2001, I had a period where I wasn't working, but I had the money to sit at home and study stuff, and I had always felt that God had wanted me to preach, and I'd been maybe avoiding that call. So I began a kind of detailed study on my own to fulfill the obligations that I felt as a Christian, to be able to explain to other people why they should also believe. And I didn't just fail, I failed phenomenally as I actually began to investigate the issues, the arguments for the existence of God, the arguments for Christianity, the arguments from biblical prophecy, everything you can think of that most people would say is the reason why they are a theist or a Christian. When I investigated it, honestly, with no preconceptions, I found that they all failed, that the objections of the skeptics and the atheists and the agnostics and the, and by the way, the people from other religions. If you want to find out what's wrong with your religion, one of the best places you can go is to some other religion. Jews will tell you why Jesus is not the Messiah. I mean, you can't beat that. And over a period of a couple of years, I eventually had to acknowledge, not a choice in belief, but that I had been convinced that my previous beliefs were wrong, that I was mistaken. I was misled by bad information, by preconceptions and preferences, by overemphasizing feelings and the unexplained, you're in church and you're singing a song and you get goosebumps. Well, so what? Once upon a time that was impactful. Now I realize I can get goosebumps from listening to secular music or watching secular movies, or for any number of reasons, that there's nothing real behind that.
You're just sort of hitting your limbic system there.
Yeah.
Yeah, my experience was not quite as scholarly as yours, but again, I did have a Christian upbringing. My parents, to this day, they're devout Episcopalians now. But when I...
That's like Christianity Light, though, isn't it?
In terms of not being, hardcore right-wing, Southern Baptists. And the Baptist church, again, like you, was the one that I was actually raised in. And it was only until, after I got out of the house that they decided, well, we want to go back to our original, the Episcopal church.
So baptism leads to atheism.
Stop
interrupting now. Go ahead.
It could very well. I mean, certainly it did to me in my case. A lot of people, a lot of believers that I talk to are really, really baffled when I tell them that I have nothing but incredibly pleasant experiences of being a youth in church and doing all the activities and all the fun stuff we used to do. I mean, when I was 14 in eighth grade, I went to a church camp that summer, and that was a blast. And I saw what, to this day, I think is the ultimate exercise in sort of, pastoral manipulation in terms of how to work an audience from the guy who was the guest pastor at that camp. It was brilliant. It was performance art practically. what this guy did. And we would do lock-ins in the rec room at the church, you know, overnight. You got to, you know, stay up all night, and that was all kinds of incredible fun when you're 13, 14 years old.
Oh, yeah. Pizza and games.
Yeah, so a lot of people, when they hear me describe that, they're, well, why did you then, you know, become an atheist? Why did you give that all up? I said, well, first off, the fun you may have in sort of in a certain social environment has nothing to do with, you know, what I decide is or is not true about there being a, you know, a God and a Jesus and all these sorts of miracles and other, and, you know, talking snakes and donkeys and whatever other kind of supernatural claims are being made by this belief system. Despite all of that, the great deal of fun that I would have as a kid.
I've sort of crassly compared it to going to a strip club. You can have a lot of fun there, but the idea
it's
that
not real. It's not
is
real.
An illusion,
yeah.
Believe me.
It's not real. Yeah, the it's ultimately it came down to several factors, but a lot of it was a process. I think a lot of Christians, when they ask us this question, well, why did you guys, you know, what made you become atheist? Were you ever a Christian before? They're looking for sort of the atheist version of the conversion experience.
Yeah.
You know, the road to there is no sort of atheist road to Damascus. What you usually find is that it is this long process that you go through, and sometimes quite often very confusing and painful, where you are suddenly, for one reason or another, prompted to think about the beliefs that you are taught in a church environment, and then how you see those beliefs either fitting in or conflicting with stuff you're actually observing in the real world. That was what hit me. And a process of deciding that, well, no, the beliefs you've been raised in aren't really standing up to scrutiny. Yeah. And so that's kind of how, so there wasn't like this one defining moment. It was just over time, I just said, yeah, you know, I mean, yeah, they're all nice folks, and I enjoyed the lock-ins, but, and the racquetball courts, but I just don't believe this God business, you know. I'm sorry. I just don't believe in heaven and hell, and this whole notion of people who, if they're just not members of the club, being tortured for eternity. How can that possibly be fair or decent or right? What kind of it can't possibly be a good loving God that would do that? Would just consign you to this sort of thing simply because you weren't a member of his fan club? Simply because you haven't done the altar walk, and, you know, the altar call, and gone up and
yeah. By the way, whose instructions on how to get to heaven are actually correct?
Yeah. So it kind of struck me that a really loving God would be more along the lines of just, you know, wanting to make sure you're okay.
And don't be a dick and you get to come up and join
us.
It should just be that simple.
Yeah, it would have nothing to do with a certain club membership, but it would just be more along the lines of, but at the same time, you know, just some sort of hell that you go to be, you know, have your butt poked by demons for eternity just struck me as being, you know, an incredibly petty thing for some all-powerful being to do.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, me just spending my entire life just burning ants with a magnifying glass. I mean, I would think that...
You'd eventually get bored.
Yeah. You know, it just what gratification am I getting out of tormenting something that is entirely helpless in front of me anyway?
So now we've both talked and given you the short version of long stories. Did you have another question?
No, that was it.
Okay. Well, thanks for calling, man. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Alex.
Okay.
Yeah, that one actually, you know, I've written it a number of times, my story of going from being, you know, a Christian to an outspoken atheist.
It's different for everyone.
I've written it. I've talked about it on the show. It comes up quite a bit, both in email and on the show. And, every time I tell it, I have some little memory from my past that comes back. And when you were talking about from, you know, lock-ins and having fun, basically Paul gives the instructions to every Christian that you need to be ready at all times to provide the reason for the faith that you have. I was serious about that. And the word there in the Greek, for you Bible geeks like me, is logos. It doesn't just say, I believe because I believe. You can't give some cop-out. There's a logical, reasonable reason. Now, even I'm not saying, you know, if you believe because God has specifically spoken to you, well, that's fine. That's a great, you know, you are probably justified, but it doesn't justify for anybody else because he didn't speak to me. Your personal revelation is just hearsay to me.
You know, it's how do you, okay, you say that you've had these divine experiences or this contact with God or that you have this knowledge of God, but how do you intend to communicate that to me? How can you help me distinguish between... distinguish your God as something that is real apart from something that just exists in your imagination.
By the name of Ted Haggard, who stumbled from the path, or you might even say staggered. He was one in a million, or more aptly, one in ten. Some folks say he put the men in amen.